What's that? Good morning. I have to say that I am in my element today. I love sunny weather. I love the sunshine. There is nothing better than sunny days. Welcome to our worship service. I ask that you prepare your hearts to worship the Lord. And now for the preload.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Let's open in prayer. Father, we thank you that you leave signs everywhere that you exist and that you care for us. From our planet that is perfectly situated to give us just enough warmth and to allow us to view the stars, to sunny days, to friendships, Father, we bow before you and thank you for all that you give us and for your Son. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now Mindy is coming up to give a children's story.
The kids want to come up and sit down up here? Come on up. No, okay, fine. My kids are just going to hang out in their seats. So our book today is called Jesus Loves New Friends. The world has many special ways to think and dress and speak, and Jesus knows those differences make each of us unique. You see? Whenever people felt alone, Jesus went and found them. He knew they'd make amazing friends and loved to be around them. Lucas. A woman from another land was visiting a well. She didn't have the same beliefs, and everyone could tell. But Jesus wanted to be friends. He didn't walk away. The woman was so happy to meet Jesus on that day. Zacchaeus had a job collecting money for the king. Most people didn't like the ones who did this sort of thing. But Jesus knew that deep inside he had a caring heart. Their friendship touched Zacchaeus, and he made a brand new start. See, Jesus loves all kinds of friends, together having fun. We may not think or look alike, but in God, we are one. So if our skin is dark or light, or if we're short or tall, our differences are wonderful. The Lord God loves them all. Because everyone's important, and Jesus says it's true. He's always glad to spend some time with special friends like you. And when we live like Jesus, being kind to all we know, we'll feel God's love and make new friends wherever we may go. That's it.
Thank you, Mindy. Could the ushers come up and bring the offering, and Nelson will give the offering prayer.
Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for the many gifts that you've provided for us, for income. And we just ask now that you would bless what we've given back to you. We pray that you would multiply it, use it to minister to our neighborhood, to our country, and to our world, and use it to be a blessing wherever it goes. In your name we pray. Amen.
Skill to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at his right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take him at his word and Christ died to save me, yes I read. And in my heart I find the need of him to be my Savior. That he would leave his place on high and come for sinful men to die. You got a stream, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves me, my Savior lives, my Savior is always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves me, my Savior lives, my Savior is always there for me. Yes, living, dying, let me go. My strength, my solace from the spring. Daddy, who lives to be my king, once died to be my Savior. That he will lead his place on high and come for for sinful men today. You cut strings, so as did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior is always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is. My Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives.
All that this world has to offer, the here and gone that leaves you wanting more but can't satisfy. Father, forgive me for taking so long to see that you're all I need. With every heart beat in my chest, Lord, I surrender all that I have. The days yet to come, the days in the past, I'm giving you all I am. With lifted hands, with lifted hands, show me mercy when I've done nothing to deserve it. You see the best in me beneath the dust, 'cause that's how you love, that's how you love. You rush through my sin with every heart beat in my chest. In the past, I'm giving you all I am. With lifted hands, with lifted hands. Heaven or grave, there is no place I can go to escape your love. Heaven or grave, there is no place I can go to escape your love. So with every heart beat in my chest, Lord, I surrender. All that I have, the days yet to come, the days in the past, I'm giving
I don't know if others have this experience or not, but for me, there are a number of scripture verses that perfectly summarizes the Christian faith. And one of them is Hebrews 11:6, which says in part, "For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him." When I read Psalm 100, the scripture verse for the day, for some reason, the words of Hebrews 11:6 came to mind. Listen to me as I read Psalm 100 and see if you can see a man or a writer who genuinely believes that God exists and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Psalm 100. "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. It continues throughout all generations." Blessings upon you, Nelson.
Thank you. I know that we would tend to say that the thing that most connects us to God is prayer. But I'm going to suggest that a very close second is worship, and you could even argue that worship is prayer. So for that reason, the sermon this morning is going to be a sermon pretty much about what and why worship. And the reason I say that is because if I would say this sermon is about how we worship, I could take a poll. I could go around here and I could say, "How do you worship? How do you worship? How do you worship?" And we would get this broad range of ways that we worship, or what really helps us to worship. And I love that. That's great. But I can't tell you what works for you. And you can't tell me what works for me. So I'm not going down that road this morning. And another reason to not go down that road is that's one of the most disruptive things in churches. For some reason, I guess because worship is so personal. It is. I mean, it's just when we worship, plus in a setting where the worship is different than it works for us, sometimes we get a little judgmental. And so just my caution this morning is don't judge other people by the way they worship. And we'll leave it at that. Am I not connected well here this morning? You can turn this mic on.
First Chronicles 16, verses 23 to 25. Give us a really wonderful illustration of worship. I'll just use this mic. This will be fine. I'll take it back with you, Jack. Pay attention as I read through this and think about worship in relation to these verses. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Share the news of his saving work every single day. Declare God's glory among the nations. Declare his wondrous works among all people. Because the Lord is great and so worthy of praise, he is awesome beyond all gods. Now, not all these words are in that passage, but they're all implied in that passage. Key words of worship: singing, honor, glory, adoration, proclamation, reverence, praise, and devotion. So you begin to see right away that worship has a broad span. It covers so many different areas and aspects. Jesus suggested that worship is a matter of choice when he said to his disciples, "No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other." And he specifically says you cannot serve both God and mammon. So he's making the point that we all have idols in our life, and worship demands that we put God at the top of any small g God that there might be in our life. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for gathering us here this morning. We thank you for this opportunity to worship, to fellowship, to gather, to study your word, to sing, to enjoy your presence. And I just ask that you would bless this message this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. I'm going to begin with the first two commandments from Exodus 20. These are the key commandments that relate to God specifically and our relationship to God. So we start with verses 1 to 3 of Exodus 20. It says, "And God spoke all these words, 'I am the Lord your God.'" And think about worship as I read this. "Who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me." So the initial thing that we acknowledge is that God is good, that God loves us, that God has reached out to us. He is our Lord, as it says, "I am the Lord your God." And what makes him so good in their eyes at this point is the Exodus, that he brought them out of Egypt. And then the demand of worship is that you have no other gods before the God Yahweh. Second commandment, "You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on earth beneath or in waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." Now, let's just be honest here. There's probably no one sitting here that has an image at home on a counter or on a bookshelf or somewhere that every day you go and kneel down to it. Is anybody like that? I know you wouldn't raise your hand if you did. Anyway, that's not our thing. That's not our problem. It's not our issue. But it doesn't mean this doesn't apply. I don't have my wallet on me, but I'd pull my wallet out and say, "Right here, here's a God. We don't bow down to it, but we have a tendency to worship money." Or maybe you got a new car. Maybe that thing, you just love that car. That's just, oh, you just can't imagine having anything better than this. We have all these things that we have a tendency, it's probably a little bit strong to say we worship them, but we hold them a little higher esteem than what we should. And God is saying, "I'm jealous of that love you have for those things." And it might even be people. I'm not saying you shouldn't love people, but they should not be put above God. So the first illustration I'm going to use is a very short passage from 1 John 4, 7 and 8. What John does in this epistle, throughout this epistle, read it sometime, he demonstrates for us that love is the epitome of worship. It's the essence. Without love of God and of others, there's really no worship of God. So simply these two verses, "Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love." So you see the connection between worship and love. We only really worship God when we love God and love others. So the key text this morning, the one that Lee read for us, comes from Psalm 100. I'm sure as he read it, you could see why this is, I would say, the predominant text for describing worship. It's a psalm that gives us an idea of what it means to offer up grateful praise. Now, you wouldn't have to say grateful if you're saying praise, and you wouldn't have to say praise if you're saying grateful. They mean the same thing. But what the psalmist does is helps us to emphasize those things. Beginning at verses 1 and 2, this describes the how a little bit, so we're getting into that just a little bit, but mostly we're going to be talking about the what and the why. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Now, there's three things to highlight from this verse. Shout for joy. It indicates emotion. It indicates passion. Now, I'm not saying that that's something you need to do in worship all the time, but in whatever way it works for you, it's important to show emotion and passion. There are times when we're singing a song here on church when it's not something that I even know is going to happen and I will get tears. And I just go, thank you, Jesus. There's some emotion, there's some passion that comes with this. And oftentimes that emotion is something that is God directed and he just gives it to us. Just thank him for it. If you like to shout, I don't care. Say amen. I miss Jim whenever he's not here because I usually get a couple amens for him in a sermon. But you don't do it for me. You do it because it's an emotion that is prompted from God. Secondly, worship with gladness. It adds an attitude. It's the mind. An attitude that's important in worshiping God. So what we're talking about is worshiping with the whole body, mind, and spirit. The third thing is come before him. It involves an intentional act of presenting ourselves to God. And so we live stream our services now, and that's wonderful, and I'm glad for the people who are able to worship at home. And perhaps they do, maybe you do at home, get involved intentionally in some sort of act of worship. But once we're here gathered together, it's an even more intentional. You had to get in your car. You had to drive here. You had to walk in the building. You had to sit down. It took some energy. And that's a key aspect of worship. It's not passive. Going on in this psalm, a why of worship. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. What better reason do you need to worship God in that we are his people? It's a saying sometimes you'll say, those are my people. Well, that's what God says. You are my people. You belong to me. You are my sheep, and I care about you deeply. A little bit more of how of worship. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Notice the body action. And his courts with praise, some verbal action. Give thanks to him and praise his name. There's an attitude. And so how, it doesn't describe that you have to raise your hands, you have to clap, you have to shout. It's not talking about, it's saying that do something physical. And something physical might mean you closed your eyes. Or you were just overwhelmed by something that you just feel in your body. And then some more why of worship. For the Lord is good. What better reason do you need to worship? And his love endures forever. Wow, isn't that amazing? And his faithfulness continues through all generations. So it wasn't just something for the Old Testament. It wasn't just something for the New Testament. It's something for all time. That is a fabulous reason to worship God. The Lord is good and his love endures forever. God's faithfulness continues through all generations. And so the application that I want to offer this morning, very simple and short, one passage, and then I'll go to another passage. What we discover is God wants to know that we aren't just going through the motions when we worship him. That's made clear in David's Psalm of Confession, Psalm 51. You know enough about King David to know that he had a lot that needed to be confessed. And here is his confession in Psalm 51, 15 to 17. So David's prayer, psalm prayer is, open my lips, Lord, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, you, God, will not despise. So there's all kinds of actions we can take. And again, I mentioned there are ways to worship that are valuable, but there are also times that perhaps you're just going through the rituals. And David is saying, I understand, God, that you want it from the heart. A story that came to me as I was preparing this sermon was when June and I were traveling out west during my sabbatical back in 2006, we went with my brother to a Catholic service, partly because of the building. It was an old mission, and it was a wonderful place to visit. But we sat in on a worship service, the Catholic service, which is like almost like a foreign language to me. And everything is liturgy. They actually gave you a paper to follow the liturgy, and that was fine, so we didn't get lost. But the thing that struck me was there was a young woman standing in front of us. She knew this liturgy inside out. And I would guess she was 16 or 17 years old. She had probably gone to Catholic school where they said this liturgy regularly. But what struck me was there was absolutely no emotion, no expression on her face. It was just words. Now, I can't speak to her heart, but it seemed to me that she was just going through the motions. And this is what the psalmist is talking about here. He's saying, ritual is of no value to God. Worship comes from the heart. And so the Apostle Paul helps us to apply this, to think about what worship really is. And so we're going to take a little bit of time and go through Colossians 3, 12 to 17. I refer to this as an introduction to corporate worship. So a lot of times we think about how do we worship at home, maybe in our quiet time, but how do we worship together, or what does worship involve when we're gathered together in corporate worship? Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves, or in other words, put on passion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. So you see the connection between attitude and behavior and worship. And so if we leave here and we go down the street here and somebody does something we don't like and we lay on the horn and we tailgate them 3 miles down the road, does that sound like worship? No. It's important for us to understand that the ways we live our lives every day is the most powerful worship we can express. So we can sing wonderful songs here, read great scriptures, even have flowery prayers. But if our lives don't reflect the fruit of the Spirit, I'm going to suggest that God is going to say that was not worship. Verse 13 begins to talk about relationships and their relationship to worship. Bear with each other. In other words, put up with each other's idiosyncrasies. We've all got them. And forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And that reminded me of a verse from the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus' words to us, he said, therefore, if you're offering your gift at the altar, in other words, if you've come to worship, and there you remember your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there. Walk out of church, in other words. Leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to that person. Then come and offer your gift. Your worship is worthless if you have worship. Over all these virtues, the things that were listed earlier, compassion and kindness and so on, put on love, which bind them all together in perfect unity. I always like Paul's analogies of getting dressed or putting on armor or getting ready for the day to live as Christians. And so here he says, put on love. It covers everything. And verse 17 then emphasizes peace and unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your heart, so we understand that it comes from inside. Since as members of one body, you were called to peace. And then he sort of adds an afterthought. And then be thankful. Because he's saying that when we act out this way, when we live this way, when we love, when we demonstrate peace and unity, we feel a connection to God. The worship is there. And then we can be thankful. We can say, thank you so much, God, for drawing me closer. And Paul says, let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach, listen to all these forms of worship, and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. So in other words, worship involves teaching, which I'm doing here, which Paul did a little bit ago in Sunday school class. Admonishing, it might mean that one of your best friends says, you know what? I saw something you did that maybe that wasn't so good. Sharing scripture, whether that's in a Sunday school class, a small group, or wherever that setting might be. And singing songs. All of these forms of worship are what draw us closer to God. And then Paul wraps it up in verse 17 by speaking to our daily lives. And whatever you do, in other words, all day long, the things that you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. One more illustration comes from John 4, 19 to 24. And I found it interesting that in the story that Mindy read, there was a reference to the Samaritan woman at the well. Now, I'm not going to use the whole story. It's a long story. It's a wonderful story about Jesus ministering to a woman across all kinds of cultural boundaries, which you could talk about worship in that. But right smack in the middle of this story, where the woman was clearly getting uncomfortable with what was going on, she changed the subject. And that's the part of the story that I'm going to reference. John 4, 19 to 24. As you know, there was always a conflict between the Jews and the Samaritans, and especially about worship and about where to worship. So the Samaritan woman says, sir, speaking to Jesus, she says, I can see that you are a prophet. And now she kind of goes off on a tangent. Our ancestors worshiped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem. Woman, Jesus replied, believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. The key point that Jesus is trying to make here is that you can worship literally anywhere. And it made me think of this past year. For 11 weeks, we worshiped on Zoom. It wasn't ideal, but we could do it because you can literally worship anywhere, anyway. And then for 14 weeks, we worshiped in the Grove. There were some people that weren't able to be there because of the uneven ground, so they worshiped at home on the live stream. Jesus is just reminding us it doesn't matter where, it can be done anywhere. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the spirit and in truth. It doesn't use the word heart there, but it implies it's what comes from within and what we receive within. The thing I want to remind you more than anything else this morning is that worship is connected to the heart and to love. It's about an attitude. If we don't love, if we don't seek peace and unity, if we don't walk in the ways of the Lord, then we can't pretend that we are worshiping Him. If our lives don't bear out a lifestyle of Christianity, it's not worship. The ultimate form of worship is to bear the fruit of the Spirit. The writer to the book of Hebrews offers these words that I want to leave with you this morning. Hebrews 12, 28 to 29 from the Good News Bible. Let us be thankful. Let us be grateful and worship God in a way that will please Him with reverence and awe, because our God is indeed a destroying fire. I don't leave this with you to make you feel negative or scared, but to remind you that there are consequences if our heart isn't in our worship. If we're just going through the rituals or the motions, there are some negative consequences. But there's wonderful power connection to the God of the universe when we worship Him in spirit and in truth. Let's pray. Lord, we thank You again for Your word that challenges us, that speaks to us, that teaches us, that reminds us that You love us dearly. You want to connect with us. And so we decide to offer our praise to You. We love You and adore You. In Your name we pray. Amen. Lee?
Thank you, Nelson. Now's the time in the service that we have sharing and prayer requests. Does anybody have anything to share or any prayer requests? If so, Jack has the microphone and we'll bring it around.
Speaking of the faithfulness of God and that He is good, today, as you know, and people have said, it's my birthday. It adds up to 82 years. And I said this morning, how did that happen? And then out of curiosity, I said to Marcia, I said, how many days is that? And she said, she figured it out. It's close to 30,000 days. And it adds a new perspective to the goodness of God in my life. And I thank Him for that.
Happy birthday, Edith.
Good morning. This is Mindy Cohn. Last week I shared about Jacob, and on Tuesday he called, but it was nothing but bad words and harsh feelings. And I've asked him to try and move forward and to start a relationship again, and he said it was too late for that, and asked that I no longer call or text him, and that any contact I have with him is through his father. So if you could just continue to pray for his heart and for our family, I would really appreciate it. Thank you.
Not seeing any other. Oh, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank You, Father, for Edith, her presence in this congregation. For her influence on my life, Father. I'm sure others here. Father, I thank You for this congregation. I thank You that that you do exist and that you do reward those who diligently serve you and seek your face. Father, I ask that you bless the Kern family. I ask blessings upon Jacob and his father. Thank you, Father, that you do hear us. Thank you, Father, that you look after us as a father would. Thank you that you allow us to come before you. And for this, we are grateful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have some announcements. Tuesday, the leadership team meets at 7 p.m. Wednesday, quilting meets, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. And Wednesday night, there's men's Bible study. Does anybody else have any announcements?
This is Pastor Nelson. This could have been under the prayer request, but I also wanted to make a couple announcements, so I'll include everything. Customers and people kept coming to me and saying how wonderful our people were. We really witnessed to this community yesterday. I think we need to, I don't know if you say pat yourself on the back, but we did a great job. So thank you to all. Some of you are aware that we sent out an email proposing that we would drop COVID restrictions June 6th. I've only gotten positive responses. If there's anybody that has a negative response to that, please let me know. We want to hear from everyone. And last but not least, we need help to carry four really heavy tables down to the basement after church. And I've talked to a couple people, but the more that can help, the faster it goes. Thank you.
I just want to echo the spring fling. I really missed not having it last year. We kind of did a yard sale inside, and that was okay. But just being outside and seeing people's faces, being able to reach out to people, to pray for a woman yesterday that needed our help, and just to see our church come together again like that was fabulous. I mean, almost everybody here today was there yesterday in some way, shape, or form helping. And as tired as I was yesterday afternoon and night, I just went to bed with a smile on my face because I felt like, in a way, our church was back. And I just want to thank everyone.
Paul Breitigan, there's a repeat announcement. In 2 weeks, again, Annie and I won't be here, so the adult Sunday school class in a combined classroom will not be having Sunday school again. That's June the 6th. Thank you.
Good morning. This is Barb Sanchez. If you could take notice of the sign-up sheet for the children's story, we could use some more people to take a turn. I think the adults enjoy those children's stories as much as the kids, if you really want to know the truth. So it's a special time, and we can use your voice in reading a story. Thanks.
Okay, not seeing any other hands. We have a closing music selection.
I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in, and then a little light from heaven filled my soul. It bathed my heart in love and wrote my name above, and just a little talk with Jesus made me whole.
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him all about our troubles.
He will
hear our faintest cry, answer by and by.
Now when you
feel a little prayer wheel turning, know a little fire is burning, find a little talk with Jesus makes it right,
makes it right.
I may have doubts and fears, my eyes be filled with tears, but Jesus is a friend who watches day and night. I go to him in prayer, he knows my every care, and just a little talk with Jesus makes it right,
makes it right. Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him all about our troubles.
He will
hear our faintest cry, answer by and by.
Now when you
feel a little prayer wheel turning, know a little fire is burning, find a little talk with Jesus makes it right,
it makes it right,
it makes it right.
Let's stand together for the benediction. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Amen. You may go in peace.